Joining us this morning to talk more about this are Professor Edna Ko, the Director of UP in Clark and Olongapo, and a former Dean of the UP National College of Public Administration and Governance, and Associate Professor Jean Franco of the UP Political Science Department. Good morning, Professors Ko and Franco. Thank you so much for waking up early to join us this morning.
Good morning, Mike.
Good morning, Nikki.
Good morning, Nikki.
Good morning.
Now, we have lots to talk about this morning, but let me begin with Professor Ko. Did you anticipate Vice President Leni Robredo eventually deciding to run for president? Because a few weeks ago, you indicated she was more likely to go local.
Well, actually, everybody, not just myself, was kind of put, we were walking on a tiptoe. Will she? Won't she? It was, everybody was guessing whether she will or she won't. But as we get closer to the date of the filing of candidacy, I got this strange feeling, and the drumming from the air just sounded like she was going to run. Her retreat to her hometown was an indication that she was making a very strong decision, a very serious decision. And I thought that was the clue. That was the cue that she'll come up with a very bombastic, a very major declaration. And she did yesterday. So now we put a period to the question mark. We put we clinch the statement now.
All right. Now, how about you, Dr. Franco or Professor Franco? Did you foresee Vice President Leni eventually running? Because she did acknowledge in her speech that she did not intend to run. So what was it that made her run, in your opinion?
Well, she said a while back that she was running if Bongbong Marcos was running. So she fulfilled her statement a few weeks ago.
Mm-hmm. But was it merely just Bongbong Marcos is running? Because I know that in her speech, she did mention, she referred to candidates not being clear about their position on certain issues. And was that a reference to Manila Mayor Isko Moreno?
Yeah, I guess her running, as I said before, sends a very strong signal that we have an opposition. Our democracy is vibrant.
Mm-hmm. And what do you make of how VP Leni presented herself yesterday? From the content of the speech to how she delivered it, was it a strong speech in your opinion?
Yeah, I thought it was a very powerful speech. She alluded to the nation by using the family as a metaphor, and she framed herself as a nanay who is fighting for the family, which is the nation. And all of us have mothers, so I think that was a good start.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Professor Ko? Do you think VP Leni's speech was effective? Because first, she discussed why she was running. There were portions where she mentioned the pandemic. She hit the incompetence of the current administration. And of course, as Dr. Franco mentioned, reference to being a mother or nana. And finally, a call to stand together. Your thoughts?
Actually, what was prevailing in my mind when she made her declaration was she solved the many questions that people were raising before yesterday. And that was decisiveness. She overturned the many comments about her indecision, her tiptoeing. And yesterday in her speech, she certainly was beyond a woman, beyond a mother. She was a leader to me. The leader is someone who makes the clear decision, heading on and being prepared for what is to come and what is to face for. And to me, that was very clear in her statement. I mean, this is a decisiveness. It was like, but also the character of strength, because just like in a telenovela or in a drama or in a film, where here is a person who was from day one of her being vice president, she was relegated to the margins, deprived of major position and power and resources. Here she comes with a vengeance to say, we will have to stand together. And that to me, again, is a sign of leadership, having to rally behind, symbolizing someone who can rally people around her and say, let us stand together and we will head on and face the challenges. So to me, mother, woman, leader.
And how about the way she delivered it? Because I, of course, that's a prepared speech. Because normally if you look at her, if you watch her in her interviews, there are some mannerisms in the way she speaks that kind of some observers would say would indicate tentativeness or indecisiveness. But none of that in yesterday's speech. Do you think that was a deliberate attempt on her part to really be a more firm and appear resolute in the face of this campaign?
Actually, in many interviews prior, her statements were commented on by some people to be a bit repetitive, repeating some phrases. But this time, yesterday, it was very short, brief, one word, one phrase, but very strong. And I think that was well prepared, that was well thought out. The power of language was there. And it was a different Lenny Robredo I saw in terms of delivering her speech and putting into words a very crucial and key decision in her life and in the nation's life.
Now, also interesting is that VP Lenny did not wear yellow this time. Instead, she wore blue with a pink ribbon. Do you think using pink and blue will be effective? And is it too late to actually shed off the yellow tag? Yes, go ahead, Dr. Ko.
Well, actually, if everybody realizes it, the color of the Liberal Party is blue and yellow. I think the yellow was shed off because of the moniker Dilawan. And I think the character of being a liberal minded woman is still there in her. She carries the blue part, but not the yellow part. But on the other hand, the pink, I think, is quite interesting. It's very attractive. Everybody was talking about pink. Yesterday, the air was about pink. And I thought that was very, wise, well thought out, I would say, that the two colors, the blue and the pink, is already a statement of inclusivity, of embracing, of going beyond the yellow. I think that's the word. It's going beyond the yellow. It's being blue. It's not being yellow. It's blue and pink and everyone. So it's a color of inclusivity. And that's another brand which was very smart.
Professor Pro.
Ma'am Ko, if I may just ask, what do you think about her getting Bam Aquino as her campaign manager? Do you think the support of the Aquinos would matter at this point, these 2022 elections? Or is it purely a strategic move?
Well, I think I will give respect to the Sambayan Coalition, because from what Brother Armin said, it was discussed in the Sambayan Coalition that Senator Bam Aquino would handle the campaign. But if you will ask me, it should not be centered on the senator, with my due respect to Senator Bam. I think there can be a whole group of people, and I'm sure they will consider that, a whole group of people, maybe more inclusive, not simply representing the Liberal Party, but if there is really a coalition campaign, it should really be a coalition, a team that should work around the campaign or behind the presidential bet.
Let me just go back to Professor Franco and going back to the topic of the choice of the color yellow. Now, was that choice moving away from yellow, the color most identified with Aquino's and Liberal Party, and her decision to run as an independent candidate, is this a deliberate move to veer away from the Dilawan versus DDS narrative?
Yes, I think that is really the case. As Dr. Ko said earlier, this is part of Lenny's rebranding. She wants to be more inclusive in her statements and in her public persona and in her platform of governance. And, you know, considering what she is up to, I think this is a good start. No, she has to veer away from the Dilawan narrative because this did not win them votes in the 2019 elections.
Mm-hmm. And how about the choice of Senator Keiko Pangilinan as VP Lenny's running mate? Do you think this is a strategic move?
I guess so, because Senator Kiko Pangilinan has been a senator for a long time. He has a lot of laws passed. He performed very well as a senator for the longest time already. And I think he will bring vigor and enthusiasm. It will be a major boost to VP Lenny's candidacy.
Mm-hmm. And Professor Ko, if VP Lenny wanted to move away from the Liberal Party, why choose a stalwart of the Liberal Party like Senator Pangilinan?
Exactly a question in my mind, that if one was to be the candidate of all and for all. But as I understand the coalition, I think they are going to tackle the matter today, that they will eventually, finally, this is the last day of filing of candidacy, they will decide again. Very quickly, but I hope thoroughly, to consider inclusivity and the broadness really of the representation in the carrier of the Sambayan Coalition. But I think the name of Kiko Pangilinan was included in the list, but there's a good long list of other possibilities as well. So I think we will see at the end of the day today whether it is indeed another a Liberal Party stalwart who will be behind VP Lenny.
For both of you, how do you think VP Lenny's announcement will affect her standing in the presidential surveys? Will we see a rise in her ranking? Professor Franco.
Yeah, I guess definitely it was yesterday was kind of a major boost in her all the doubts, all the the tiptoeing and the dilly-dallying that were perceived to be a part of her being indecisive proved to be wrong. No, and I think it is going to be a good start for her in the run-up to the 2022 elections.
Mm. Professor Ko, on social media, we saw actually a lot of posts in pink, a reference to her choice of color. But do you think this is just the echo chamber that we're in? How do you think this will go beyond social media and extend to the masses, to the population outside social media?
I think there was some kind of a semi-euphoria yesterday. You felt it in the air. It was all over social media. And the number was really astounding of those who were jubilant about the declaration of VP Lenny. And I think that was a result of an expression of hope, an expression that finally we wanted to hear from her. And finally, she made a declaration and people were so joyous about it. I think that's one thing. But in the coming days, things will have to unfold and we'll see how things go. Again, it is important how VP Lenny and the campaign team would some sort of very smartly sustain the energy that was manifested yesterday. I think your question earlier, from day one, I was saying, I am not someone who believes entirely or strongly on the survey because the survey is about a particular point in time. At the time when she has no statement, that she has no declaration, that she showed hesitancy to run, I expected that she's not going to come rise up in the survey. Because if you're a regular voter, I think we have to look at it from the point of view of a voter as well. If I'm a voter, I would say, well, who's available anyway? And even if I like X person, but doesn't make herself present or available, I have to look elsewhere and to explore other possibilities. I think that's human nature. And therefore, when she declared yesterday, I think that personally, we will expect people to have a stronger indication of support for someone who makes herself available.
Now let's talk about the effect of her running on other candidates. Because yesterday, we saw the hashtag Withdraw Isko trending. Manila Mayor Isko Moreno's Cap declined to comment on that. But why do you think, of all the candidates, Isko was the one the VP Lenny supporters are asking to withdraw, Professor Franco?
Well, maybe because of the belief by some sectors that it's too early for Isko. He is relatively young with little experience. And some people might want him to be the vice presidential candidate of Lenny. So I guess it's part of the campaign to, you know, to discredit some people, some candidates that disappointed some portion of the electorate.
Mm-hmm. And Professor Ko, do you see the likelihood of any of the other candidates giving way for VP Lenny? And if so, who among them would likely be the one to give way?
I am still hopeful that things can be sorted out between among candidates. And we cannot discount the possibility of some candidates who, despite filing, can bend mm-hmm. backward and say, all right, let's move together, let's have unity. There's a long period of time between now and November 15. So mm-hmm. I think that's the reason that VP Lenny was saying she doesn't give up on unifying and collaborating with other candidates. I think there is such a long time. And if you know the Pinoy psychology, sometimes we are surprised by such instant changing of mind. And so we cannot discount that possibility, especially if there are indications that there is popular support, there is an increasing support for an ex-candidate. I think conversations will be more open.
Mm-hmm. Talk about changing of the mind. How about the likelihood of Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte still running for president? Because we've seen supporters mobilizing on social media, calling on her to run, but she said she won't. So is there still a chance that she will run, Professor Franco?
Just last night, there was a strong buzz that she's in Manila and she's going to file her candidacy today. We don't know whether that's true or not, but to the extent that this is still being talked about, then we are still on a guessing game, no? If she runs, no? This is just like a chess game, no? So to speak. And if she runs, it's going to really change the entire field. And it's, once again, it's more fun in the Philippines.
Right. And Professor Ko, yesterday I saw, or actually last night, I saw on social media a photo of an eagle projected on the facade of the Davao City Hall. But it turned out that this was an old photo. So what does this say about the psyche of Mayor Duterte's supporters? Is this an indication of desperation or an earnest belief that she should run for president?
I think that the Duterte's have been bringing us such wonderment, surprises. And therefore, it is very difficult to predict, difficult to tell. Something you imagine they won't do, but they are able to do, surprisingly. And therefore, until the last day, the last hour today, we will never know until the we are filled with surprises. But the other surprise is that there can be so many changes between now and November 15.
Mm-hmm. And one of that possibility, there's also the possibility of Mayor Duterte running for vice president. But if she does not run for president, who do you think will benefit from it? Is it former Senator Bongbong Marcos? Because they're saying the supporters of the Dutetes and the Marcoses do have some commonalities. So what do you think, Professor Ko?
I think that's not impossible that the winner or the gainer, not the winner, but the gainer of such, withdrawal from the presidential bet is Bongbong Marcos. And I think it is almost public and everybody knows that they do support each other and they make a very the best of allies. However, for people who there may be some section of that supporting group who can also consider other options, but by and large, I think at this point it will be difficult to automatically imagine that the choice for Sara could automatically go to Bongbong Marcos. You have a woman here who stood a little bit different from the older Duterte, and therefore that spells a bit of a change, which some people would like. But if you pull out that possibility of a little change? Will I go to someone who has not been visible, who has been underperforming in the last 5 years? We've never heard of him in the last 5 years. So how can I automatically switch there? So it should be someone who could probably equally popular or visible. And therefore, if I was someone who was supporting Sarah and she did not push through, I would consider someone else closer to that. Probably a woman, probably someone who would stand for change, someone who will be different, really a little bit, or I mean, the range of difference will matter, but it is not likely, it is not automatic that the Sarah support vote would automatically go to Bongbong Marcos.
How about you, Dr. Franco? How important is it to have a unity talk, especially if Sarah does not run?
It is very important. We are in a pandemic and we need to move forward. We need to know how this will end and whether the economy will recover in the coming years. And for the candidates, I think in the end, their love of country should be stronger than their ambitions.
Mm-hmm. And right. Just to end, we all know that Vice President Lenny did beat Bongbong Marcos the first time around when they both ran for VP. No? So what would make Bongbong Marcos actually harder to beat now? And is he really the candidate to beat?
Bongbong Marcos has a huge amount of resources, and she has spent his camp has spent a considerable amount of time, and resources revising history, and that in itself tells you that he still has a very powerful name.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Ma'am Ko?
Oh, Nikki, I think I'd look at election always. We tend to look at personalities during election. We tend to look more at the candidates. But I think I'd like to invite everyone to please have a look at the voters. And at this point in the election, where the champions are really the voters, I think the clamor of the voters is a change. I mean, from what we've been through economically, life, livelihood, our own safety, and even gotten worse during the pandemic, we don't want to be in the same situation. And therefore, the call for change. And I think that's everyone's aspiration. The rich, the middle class, the poor, who will all cast their votes, are clamoring for change. So I would look for someone who could be my passport to that so-called change. We want to get out of this situation. We want someone who can lead us and who I can identify with for change. And come on, the voters are the stars during election. And I think all the more that we have to pay attention to the voters' clamor rather than to the sterling personalities, which can really be overwhelming, confusing, cheating in a way, no? You don't see really who's who until you see the performance when one sits in office. But certainly there's quite a lot of things to do in terms of informing, getting the aspiration higher up above us all. So this is what Dr. Franco said. What is important is, what do we aspire for as a country, as a people? Let's get down to the voters, and they spell on their faces change.
Mm-hmm. Agreed, right. Ma'am Ko, Ma'am Franco, Mike.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for a very interesting discussion this morning, Professor Edna Ko and Professor Jean Franco, both from the University of the Philippines.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Nikki.